is the TV Today Network. And you are watching Headlines Today.
Welcome back. You're watching To The Point. It's time to get a political perspective on Arun Jaitley's first budget. I'm now joined by the Minister for Power and Coal, Piyush Goyal, Congress Chief Whip Jyotiraditya Sindhya, Senior CPM Politburo Member Sitaram Yechury, and BJD Lok Sabha Leader Jay Pandav. Piyush Goyal, let me put to you a comment made about Mr. Jaitley's first budget. People say there was far too much time spent on little things, 50 crores here, 100 crores there, and as a result, whatever attitudinal direction, whatever broad policy direction the budget had, simply got drowned out under these details. And many people have said this was a case of bad communication. This was a speech that had good content, but badly written and therefore failed to convey it.
Karan, you must appreciate that the finance minister is addressing 125 crore Indians. It is not that the people in the boardrooms or people on TV studios don't have the patience to hear what the common man on the street wants to hear. I think it's very important that Mr. Jaitley has communicated to such a wide section of India what is there in it for them. And I think it was very imperative that more and more people feel included in the budget, more and more people feel the sense of concern and the sense of involvement that the Narendra Modi government wants to show them and wants to work for them.
Now, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, I noticed that one of the first comments on the budget was from Sonia Gandhi, who said that the new government has continued with UPA policies. So should I therefore conclude that your party has no problem with this budget and in fact you welcome it?
Well, Karan, first of all, through you, let me congratulate Mr. Jaitley for the presentation of his first budget as finance minister. We wish him and the government well in terms of delivering on the expectations of the people. But having said that, I think that this budget is very high on rhetoric but very low on content. I think much of the expectations of the people of our country have been belied in this budget. In many ways, it does recognize the difficult situation that the world is in and India in that subcontext. Unfortunately, while they were sitting in opposition, for some reason or the other, they couldn't appreciate that position. But having said that, I think the main thing that is really missing in this budget is the fact that the stress and the importance that must be given to the social sector schemes where outlays and allocations we were expecting should be raised. That's not happened, whether it's on health, on education, across the board. There's also no signal with regard to inflation, with regard to increasing tax GDP ratio. So these are all signs that are concerning because also expectations are very high with regard to the whopping majority that the BJP have come in with. And there is no real sort of roadmap or vision for 5 years in terms of what the delivery will be at the end of the 5 years, because the budget is really not an episodic statement. It's really much more got to do with also a vision for the country, especially the first budget, 5 years down the road.
Now, Sitaram Yechury, in a very real sense, from your perspective, there's not much difference, even though they may bicker and differ amongst each other, between Congress and the BJP on economic issues. What is your CPM take on this budget? How do you view it? And what's your key criticism of it? We don't seem to have Sitaram Yechury at that point. I'm really sorry about that. Let me put a slightly different question to you, Jay Panda. I want to move away from broad perspectives of the budget to specific details. One of the things that's got Mr. Jaitley a lot of praise and applause is the way he's tackled the fiscal situation. Do you believe that the target of 4.1 and then the subsequent targets of 3.6 and 3 are credible and real, or do you think they're very heavily dependent on getting growth going? They're also dependent this year on the monsoon and whatever happens to oil as a result of Iraq. And therefore, do you accept those as challenges that he can deliver on, or do you think he's going to fail to deliver?
I'd like to make two points. And first, in answer to your question, it's very clear that the fiscal target is extremely ambitious. Just agreeing to keep it at 4.1%, which is what he inherited, is itself ambitious for this year. But to try and bring it down to 3% in the next 2 to 3 years is ambitious. But I think that it also signals. It signals the intent that they are very serious. It reminds me of something that Bill Clinton used to have in his campaign war room, a poster which said, "It's the economy, stupid." That's what the Prime Minister has been talking about. And also, this budget is very reminiscent to me of a dozen or so odd years ago, Prime Minister Vajpayee's budget, which shifted the focus into infrastructure. And that has also been seen here with 38,000 crores allocated for national highways and 15,000 crores for the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, the rural roads. These are all significant, and many other signals have been given to the manufacturing sector. The second point I wish to make is that from a...
Go ahead.
From a regional point of view, states like Odisha have been demanding revision in mineral royalties for many years.
I'll stop you there. I'll come to state-specific demands in a moment's time. Let's go issue by issue rather than one man's idea and another man's idea. I want to pick up on something you heard there, Piyush Goyal, from Jay Panda about how the fiscal deficit target is extremely challenging and maybe even something you'll miss. You've set up an expenditure management commission to go into subsidies and expenditure as a whole. Why? You've got 282 MPs behind you. You're a strong government and you have an assertive prime minister. These are political decisions. Why do you need an expenditure management commission to take political decisions about subsidies and expenditure which you can take yourself? Many people think that all this commission does is either postpone the decision down the road and provide you cover, or perhaps give you an opportunity to duck taking it altogether.
Karan, there's a very interesting insight each one of us is seeing as we took up office, and many of us are first-time ministers. We find a lot of the expenditure could be better targeted, a lot of the subsidies could be better targeted, a lot of the expenditure leaves scope for improvement in terms of efficacy of spend. There's a potential to dovetail many schemes together and make them more effective and administratively more easier to reach out to the people. Now, these are interministerial issues where I may find a few things in my ministry and Smriti may find a few in hers. A commission like this will enable all of us to exchange views and pass on the benefit of whatever little wisdom each one of us can get. I think there's potential for tremendous savings in the entire government system, which has over the years accumulated a lot of irrational expenditures. And that's the effort Mr. Jetley is trying to do.
Now, we've got Sitaram Yechury back with us. Sitaram Yechury, I want to put to you a question that allows you to give us your very different left perspective on this budget. There's a real sense in which Jay Panda, Jyotiraditya Sindhya and Piyush Goyal, even if they may differ with each other, have a view that's fairly similar on economic issues. Yours is different. We were talking a moment ago about fiscal consolidation and the fact that Mr. Jetley has accepted as a challenge 4.1. On that specific issue of fiscal consolidation, do you believe that it is the right of way of handling the country's finances, or do you think he's mistaken and he shouldn't concentrate so deeply on the fiscal concern?
There are two aspects to it, Mr. Thapa. First is the realization of what Mr. Jetley has targeted for himself and for the country. It crucially hinges upon the revenues that he is expecting, which is growth to the tune of about 17%, which is completely unrealistic given the rate of growth of the economy and the projected rate of growth and the experience that we have had in the last 2 years. So the only other way that this fiscal target can be achieved is by a very drastic contraction of the expenditures that have been, even those that have been announced in the budget. And remember, what has been announced in the budget, the capital outlays are 4% less in real terms than what was done last year. So I am afraid the net result of trying to achieve this target would be a further expenditure contraction,
okay,
which will mean a further contraction of the domestic demand. And in a global situation where your exports are unlikely to grow, the contraction of domestic demand is only going to pull down the growth rate of the economy even further.
All right. Therefore,
so
you believe...
even from that point of view, I don't think this is not together. So, therefore, second to the larger point that you mentioned very correctly, I think this concern with fiscal fundamentalism, if I may be permitted to use that word, apart from all of the fundamentalisms that the BJP may have, but this fiscal fundamentalism is not the answer.
Okay.
To actually kickstart the economy.
And you explained a moment ago very cogently why you think it's not the answer, but the contrarian view to that, Jyotiraditya Sindha, is that in fact the finance minister believes that what he's done in terms of manufacturing, what he's doing in terms of infrastructure, where many people readily accept he's given very large, substantial fillips, will actually boost growth. And that as a result, in fact, the revenues, particularly that 17% growth in taxes, will take place. Do you think he's gambled correctly, or is he being overly optimistic?
Well, I think he's trying to take on a very, very large challenge, and I must give him credit for doing that. My concern really, Karan, is if you look at the changes that have been made on the direct tax side and the indirect tax side, whereas on the UPA interim budget that we presented, it would have resulted in a positive 18,000 crore combining direct with indirect tax. In this case, it's resulting in roughly about a negative 15,000 crore, which causes a stress of close to about 33,000 crores to the already the fiscal position that is in place. If you combine that with the specter of drought, rising oil prices, and inflation, and by the way, that's one of the key issues that have not been even addressed in the budget, which is a matter of great concern to every citizen in this country. I think that raises a red flag over those whether those fiscal targets can be met or not. I certainly, as an Indian citizen, do hope that those fiscal deficit targets will be met,
okay,
because I think fiscal rectitude and fiscal management is really the call of the day today.
Let's come, Jay Panda, to the message that's gone out to international investors. On the one hand, the finance minister has raised FDI caps in insurance, he's raised them in defense. But on the other hand, when it comes to retrospective taxation, those 12 to 15 companies, the Vodafone being the most well-known of them, that are in dispute, have no solution at all. He simply said that their court cases will continue. So therefore, has he sent overall a reassuring message to international investors, or one that's a little confusing, perhaps even at times disturbing?
First of all, even before this budget, for the past 6 weeks, international investors have been demonstrating their increased confidence by pumping in much increased amounts in terms of both FDI as well as FII.
But wasn't that
and
in expectation?
You're absolutely right about the...
Wasn't that an expectation?
Right. So you are right about... Let me just complete. You are absolutely right that the signals that have gone out today are overwhelmingly positive, I think. You know, if you take simple things like making it more attractive for fund managers to actually come and position themselves in India, these are immensely strong signals. Now, regarding the retrospective tax issue, I think it is incumbent on the finance minister, first of all, to assert that the government does have the right, but at the same time, I think in every which way he could, he has signaled that these are issues that investors should have confidence that the government will resolve in the near future.
So you think that overall he sent out the best message he could have? A quick yes or no?
Yes, absolutely yes, considering the immense constraints that he's working on. If you read the subtext, if you read the signaling on both the big issues as well as the small issues, I think it's overwhelmingly positive.
What about Piyush Goyal, GST? Here you have what seemed like contradictory things that the finance minister said. On the one hand, in his speech, he said that negotiations as well as the constitution amendment would be finished by this year. Separately, the finance secretaries indicated the constitution amendment could be presented to parliament in the winter session, maybe even passed. Yet, the finance minister didn't declare a start-up date for GST. And if he's confident that he can get the whole process completed by the end of the winter session, why didn't he say April 1, 2015, GST will roll out?
Well, I think the nation has heard so many deadlines on GST that it was more prudent for the finance minister to speak with caution. In fact, he had a very good engagement with the state's ministers. And the biggest hurdle to GST has been the lack of confidence in the central government in the last few years. Now we have a government led by Mr. Modi, which by and large is very sensitive to the concerns of the states. He has himself been a chief minister 12 years. And I think the states are having the sense of confidence that is the mechanism to allow compensation for the states who will be disadvantaged will be credible and will be enforceable. I suspect that they have given a reasonable assurance to Mr. Jetley, based on which he has assured the House and the nation through the House that by the end of the year, March, he should be in a position to roll out GST.
Now, a moment ago, Sitaram Yechury, you said that the fiscal fundamentalism, to use your phrase... Yes, absolutely. Go ahead, Jyotiraditya Sindhya.
Two quick points. One, to the point that is made about GST and DTC, as I said myself, I hope it's rolled out as soon as possible. But what I find ironical is the Prime Minister no longer agrees with the former Chief Minister of Gujarat on the objections that had been laid out with regard to the GST program, because
you couldn't
the two
resist
states that opposed
day,
the GST the most were Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat. That's number one. Number two, but anyway, I'm glad if it's been resolved, that's great, because I think as a citizen, we need it in this country. The second point that I want to make is on retrospective taxation. It certainly is a degree of comfort that a pronouncement has been made that even though the government has the right, it certainly will not be exercised liberally going forward in the future. But what is of concern, forget about internationally, but what is concerned domestically, that on where on the one hand you're saying that you will not do retrospective taxation, on the domestic market you put in a retrospective tax immediately in this budget. All those who have invested in non-equity mutual funds, if they divest it after tomorrow, will have to pay the nominal tax rate and will not get avail of the long-term capital benefit. So you actually, in one fell swoop, put a retrospective tax on those people who are investing in non-equity mutual funds in this country, debt funds or otherwise.
Just very quickly, you're talking about people who divest tomorrow onwards. So why is it retrospective? Tomorrow is the day after today.
Because I invested a year ago thinking that I'll be paying a long-term capital gain and not a nominal tax, right?
All right, I take your
because
point.
Because I made that investment a year ago.
Quite right. They changed the rules of the game after you actually started to play. I take your point entirely.
Exactly.
Let me go back to Sitaram Yechury. Sitaram Yechury, a moment ago, you said that what you called fiscal fundamentalism would end up contracting the economy and that in turn would damage growth. But you've seen a huge fillip being given to manufacturing. He's opened the door effectively to e-commerce. He's going to create 20 new industrial clusters. There are going to be a whole series of tax concessions for manufacturing enterprises. He's going to operationalize and revise SEZs. There's the Apprenticeship Act that's going to be amended. And then on top of all of that, 10,000 crore for MSEMEs and entrepreneurship. Why do you think that won't in fact give an effective boost to growth?
Because the basic point that we need to understand is giving boost to investment by itself does not lead to economic growth. You see, unless you have the purchasing capacity in the hands of the people to absorb what is produced by that investment, you cannot have growth, and it's basically common sense, forget economics. Now you have a reduction in the purchasing power in the hands of the people with this continued inflation, which you've not addressed. You have cut down on subsidies, but you have given these tax concessions in the past as well. Finance Minister circulated along with the budget, a budget document which shows you the amount of tax concessions you've given, and what did it result in? A negative rate of growth in your manufacturing,
okay.
A negative index of industrial production, a negative gross capital formation in the economy. So tax incentives by themselves to increase investments cannot lead to growth and to a positive sentiment unless you address the fundamental issue of expanding your domestic market.
Okay.
Honestly, if you really want to kickstart the economy, what you required You may find it strange, Mr. Thapa, it's coming from a communist, that, but what was required for India is actually a new deal.
Okay, I take your point. Let me bring
a massive dose of infrastructural investment, state-sponsored, because remember, PPP has an additional cost factor.
I take your point.
Please, 1 minute, you bear with me. PPP has an additional cost factor for the private element of it.
I take your point.
That is the cost of financing.
I take your point, Sita Ramachandran. You have a very different way of looking at economics and the budget from the other three, but it's important that your contrarian view be heard. I want to go back to that second area of boost in the budget, Piyush Goyal, before I come to Jay Panda. Infrastructure. Now, the finance minister believes he's done an awful lot to actually get the infrastructure development that's needed for growth going, and going in a big way. But TN9 and the chairman of Business Standard in part one of the show pointed out, where's the money to fulfill all the commitments that he's made? Unless he actually substantially reduces the expenditure on subsidies, which you aren't doing at the moment. You at best appointed a commission that will do it next year or the year after. And until then, you're hoping that somehow PPPs will take it up, which they haven't up till now, or you're hoping that foreign direct investment will come in large numbers, which they may or may not. So when it comes to infrastructure, is this a situation of promise where he may not be able to deliver?
Karan, before I answer that, since the left is usually wrong and rarely ever right, I'll just correct Sitaram's perception about revenue foregone. I don't know if he understands. Do it quickly. Let's not get deflected. Things like exemption on investments.
It's not right or left. It's always correct.
Okay, gentlemen, let's not. We're having a wonderful structured discussion. Let's keep political rivalry and polemics out of it. Remember, there's an audience that wants to learn from you people, not just what you borrow. Come back to my question now. On infrastructure.
Correct him that revenue foregone is to encourage investment and infrastructure development, which he should respect.
Piyush, the two of you, Piyush, the two of you have different viewpoints about economics.
I think the bigger problem...
The two of you have different viewpoints about economics. We're not going to sort them out tonight.
Framework.
Why don't you come back to Nainan's concern about infrastructure? Is that promise which you can't deliver on?
So the problem on infrastructure has not been about money. Coal India today has 53,000 crores of investable surplus cash. Similarly, there's a lot of money with a lot of private sector. In fact, if you see the amount of cash balances in the entire sector, in the entire private sector and public sector, it has grown in the last 3 or 4 years because the policy framework and the encouragement to infrastructure was lacking. This budget has path-breaking initiatives, and all ministers are working seamlessly. All compartments and silos have been broken. We are kick-starting the investment cycle, rapidly encouraging people to come into manufacturing, to come into creating roads, airports, shipyards. That policy framework is what the budget has offered to the people of India.
I'm going to move now beyond manufacture, beyond fiscal deficits, growth and infrastructure, and talk briefly, Jay Panda, about what this budget offers, what I might call the Aam Aadmi. There are no change in tax rates, personal exemption rates have gone up, greater exemption on home loans, ATC exemptions have gone up. Do you think in the present constrained circumstances, this is the best the finance minister could have done? You've given him credit on that count in earlier parts of this conversation and discussion. Would you give him credit here as well?
I think there had been widespread expectations among the middle class, among taxpayers, for much higher floor and more relief on the tax front. I think the finance minister has certain constraints because you're already having revenue losses of more than 22,000 crores. So what some people might consider as only incremental rationalization on the income tax front and other indirect taxes, he may have his hands tied. But on the other hand, it depends on whom you consider the Aam Aadmi. Let me give a quick comparison. Food subsidy, which was such a pet policy theme of the previous government, has increased by 25% to 1,15,000 crores. So that, in fact, directly goes to the poorest of our citizens, not the middle class.
Okay.
On the other hand, the petroleum subsidy has decreased by 26%. To now only 63,000 crores as opposed to almost 90,000 crores earlier. This is something which pinches the pocket of the middle class who have two-wheelers and four-wheelers. So I think he has actually tried to balance it as much as he can. It hasn't been uniformly good for everyone, but it does indicate a toughness of approach.
Sitaram Yechury, the very last question of this show, and it's a slightly tongue-in-cheek question, and some would consider it Karan's favorite. You're a smoker. As a smoker, and I find nothing wrong in smoking, let me add, is it right and fair, or is it morally acceptable, that cigarette excise should be kicked up from 11% to 72%, which is more than a six-fold rise? Or are you screaming when you look at that?
Well, but it doesn't affect me now, since I've moved on to e-cigarettes, like e-commerce.
In other words,
that affect
in other
me
words
now.
You're smoking
but,
in your mind.
But,
all the smoking you do is in your mind. I'm running out of time.
If the health was the concern, I think a similar thing should have been done with liquor as well. There would have been much greater revenues.
Oh my God, I've got a killjoy as a politician on the show. Let me end this discussion before we come up with other wise ideas from you. You never know, Mr. Jaitley may well take your advice for once. My thanks to all four of my guests for joining me. That was an exceptionally enjoyable discussion with four politicians. And if you happen, thanks for watching. Goodbye, good night.
Live Pure Aruka Expert presents To The Point, powered by Manavrashda International University, infinity of knowledge, in association with OA 104.8 FM, Sabse Filmi, and Ansal University, spanning decades in education.
Rahul!
Khelne do.
Hamesha bimar rehta hai.
Pani check kiya.
RO ka pani deti hu.
Bharosa sirf RO ke expert Lift Pure par.
Jiski UV aur RO 2000 membrane ki shakti har tarah ke pani ko kare sabse shuddh aur bimari rakhe hamesha dur.
Come on India, Lift Pure.
The mesmerizing Lava Iris X1 with 8MP camera, Android KitKat and quad-core processor.
How much?
7999.
Unbelievable!
Lava Iris X1. We put the art in smart.
Sangani Diamond Jewelry. Kyunki special hai wo.
Star Comprehensive Insurance Policy for your family health insurance needs. Star Health Insurance, the health insurance specialist.
Let's have a big bang, step on the juice. There's fun in the air, passion, people on the loose. Hands on the wheel, eyes on the road. Wind in my hair, running overload.
Do you get my drift?
We can take you places, cause we the Swift, we the Swift.
Naya Pigeon Super Cooker hai aapka handi, pressure cooker, strainer aur serving dish. Jo chale gas aur induction cooktop dono pe. Hai na super?
Tere naye ghar ka kya hua?
Yaar, outskirts mein bhi mehenge hote ja rahe hain. Loan ka bhi kuch...
Koi madad lage to bol dena. Chal kal milte hain.